This time, they haven't yet claimed us. We have some relationship with China, but that's to come, I'm sure, because China and Russia represent to them serious kinds of problems. But also, black people represent a serious problem to the United States government and has done so historically. That's why Malcolm X is dead. That's why Martin Luther King is dead. Russians didn't do that. That's why more than 28 members of the Black Panther Party in 1968 alone were murdered. The Russians didn't do that. That's why this community and our people have been under aggression. That's why a spy center is being developed right here in North St. Louis, even as they're pushing black people out of our homes, gentrifying us and things like that, taking away our properties, created this entity that they call a land bank administration for the purpose of stealing property from black people legally. Even as they are doing that kind of thing, they're attacking those of us who are trying to defend this community and to bring economic development to this community. That's what we do. That's what we do here. That's what we've done historically. So when it comes to this issue about Russia and Ukraine, where Russia has spent, where the United States has, in this last budget offering that I saw, talked about more than $40 billion more that they've given to this entity that they call Ukraine, the entity that they put in power after overthrowing the legitimate government in Ukraine in 2014, we're supposed to have forgotten that, to put themselves closer to the border of Russia that they have declared to be some kind of adversary, though they haven't explained to us why it's an adversary, though I don't care why they would say that. The fact is that we are able to say that we are not pacifists. We are not pacifists at all. We believe that there's a difference in just wars and unjust wars, and we are opposed to unjust wars, and we support just wars. Unjust wars are those wars that try to colonize people, keep them under tyranny, bury them under oppression, and just wars are those wars that are fought by oppressed people to liberate themselves. We don't just support Russia in this war against Ukraine. We support Palestine. Even as the U.S. government and U.S. citizens are leaving this country every day, going to Palestine, where that is murdering Palestinian Arabs on a daily basis. Don't tell us that we can't have friends that you don't like. Because the fact is, the friends that we have were people who will be opposed to murdering people in Palestine, murdering people in North St. Louis, murdering people in Afghanistan, murdering people in Syria. We would be opposed to them. And so anybody who would stand up for the liberation of those people, we're on their side. You don't have to be a Russian or anything like that, one. Secondly, yes, I have been to Russia, but I've also been to South Africa. I've been to Ghana. I've been to various other places in Africa. I've been to Nicaragua. I've been all kinds of places where oppressed people are organizing, because black people need not to be isolated. And that's what this government would do. They would have us isolated, assuming that there is nothing that we can turn to except Joe Biden, who turned loose 100,000 policemen in the street with his omnibus crime bill that's probably killed Mike Brown. And the Russians didn't kill Mike Brown, by the way. Nobody said a Russian did that. That was an American domestic soldier that they called the police that killed Mike Brown. So you want me to hate Russians? And no, I don't hate Russians, but I hate those people who killed Mike Brown. And I hate the institutions that's responsible for that. So I wanted to say that. And to be clear about that, I'm unabashedly a black man, an African that's committed to the liberation of black people, the African and all the other oppressed peoples on the planet Earth. And the United States has always historically been opposed to the liberation of oppressed people, opposed to freedom in Nicaragua, opposed to freedom in Afghanistan, opposed to freedom in South Africa. Mandela, from your perspective, at one time was a terrorist. Fidel Castro, how many times has the U.S. government tried to murder Fidel Castro? This is the reality that we are talking about, and so we are unabashedly on our own side. So I just want to say that in terms of what happened. Let me just say, they actually sent a drone into this house. They said we were not charged with anything. That's what they said. They handcuffed me and my wife out here. They wanted me to sit on the curb while they were carrying this out. Something that I refused to do. They wanted my wife to sit on the curb out here that she refused to do. Only thing we do is fight for black people, black power. All you got to do is walk through North St. Louis and you can see the changes that we brought here as a party for black people. And the government is opposed to that, and that's why we are under attack. And also because they see us as pawns that they can use in this propaganda war against Russia. That's why black people who make this mistake of assuming that what's happening in Afghanistan or what's happening in Russia and Ukraine have nothing to do with us. Clearly, it does have something to do with us. The United States government clearly says it has something to do with us. And what they have done also is tried to create a situation where there is the appearance that anybody, black people who are opposed, who criticize what the United States government is doing to us, must be the employ of Russia. Like somehow Russia killed Mike Brown. That somehow we needed the Russians to tell us that we were oppressed. That's a hell of a statement. It's a disgusting, slanderous statement that black people don't have enough sense to know who it is that's killing us, murdering us, and keeping us living in these conditions. And I've been to Russia, and I didn't see Russians living like black people live right here in North St. Louis. That's the reality. So I wanted to say that. My wife was here, too. I don't know if you wanted to say anything about what happened. Yeah, I want to hear this. I want you to hear this from different people. And this house was not the only house attacked. They attacked our office in St. Petersburg, Florida, our headquarters there. They raided it. They stole materials from us, just like they stole from this house. They stole my phone. They stole my computer. They stole computers from other members of our organization. Cell phones, they have that. They stole that from us. They said that they had a warrant for it. They may have had a warrant for it, but they didn't show it to me. And so all I saw was a thief. The thieves came in and used flashbang grenades to terrorize this entire community and stole some material from us under the color of law. It's a colonial law that we're looking at. So did you want to say anything?
Yeah, Uhuru, I just want to say that we were just sitting in the house at 5 a.m. in the morning talking like we normally talk. And the next thing we knew, we heard someone say, everyone at 4442 Redbud, come out with your hands up. So, you know, we're new to the city, so we're thinking some kind of flash flood, you know, because it's been flooding here. And then they said it again, and then we had heard all these flash bombs go off. And, you know, chairman says, come on, let's get out of here. So we chairman went out first, and then I came out. As I was coming out, this big old drone met me coming down the stairs, you know, like it was going to attack me. And they handcuffed myself and the chairman and, you know, escorted us to the side of the road and start, you know, asking us questions, which we didn't answer.
Coming down the stairs here where you are now?
In the house. So when that door, because when I walked out of the door, the house, the door was open. Let me just say that.
Go ahead. Also, they, you know, they would, you know, damage the door, you know, to get in the other apartment next to us. So, you know, if we hadn't opened the door, everything would have been, you know, slammed.
The door, you can see the window was broken there. They put a boarded up that door there. But the reality is this, even if they had a legitimate warrant, like they said, all they got to do is knock on the door. What is a flash bomb? What is being out here terrorizing the entire community of something about a search warrant? It had nothing to do with a search warrant. It had to do with this game that they are playing to keep black people oppressed and this ideological, this propaganda war that they engaged in with Russia. And we're not going to be a part of it, and they're not going to keep us from fighting for our freedom. We got a black community conference that's scheduled for the 31st, for Sunday,
31st.
Right here at Legacy. And black people are going to come out, and we're going to be free. And there are not enough FBI agents on the planet Earth to stop the struggle of black people. We're going to make that happen. We got a doula event happening right now where we're training 20 black women to be doulas. Because they kill our children. They close our hospitals down. Our babies are not able to be born safely. Black women are treated badly when they're pregnant. So we are solving that problem. That's what this government is attacking because it doesn't want that to happen. It's not going to stop us. They attacked our center and houses on the south side. There's a solidarity center that we have on the south side as well. Penny Hess is the chairwoman of the African People's Solidarity Committee that works under the leadership of the Black Revolution, the Black Power Movement.
Uhuru, thank you, Chairman Omali Yeshitela and Deputy Chair Ona Zinaya Yeshitela of the African People's Socialist Party. I want to say again, I am Penny Hess, Chair of the African People's Solidarity Committee, the organization of white people formed by Chairman Omali Yeshitela and the African People's Socialist Party more than 40 years ago in 1976 to be solidarity, to be white black power in white face behind enemy lines, to be able to go into the white community to tell the truth that the only reason that we have the Del Mar divide, that we have the two Americas, that we have the colonialism inside this country is because it's built on the enslavement of African people, the kidnapping of African human beings, and forcing them to labor for free for our benefit for hundreds of years on land in which genocide was committed against the indigenous people that is stolen from them that we live on today. That's the only reason that there's two Americas, that there are the colonizer and the colonized, the wealth and the poverty. That is the reason why. And I just want to say that we stand unconditionally in solidarity with the African People's Socialist Party, with the African working class, with African people all around the world to have their stolen resources back in the form of reparations, to have political and economic power over their lives, to have Africa, which belongs to African people everywhere, as we have learned from Chairman Omali Yeshitela, to be free and to have relationships with whomever supports them. This government does not support them. And I do want to unite with the indictment of the U.S. government, which is there to oppress African people, to colonize them, steal their resources, bring more wealth to white people every day in this city, in this country, and around the world. And I stand in solidarity with the freedom and liberation and reparations to African people. Our center, there is a Solidarity Center at 2654 Grabois near Jefferson. It is owned by the Black Star Industries and the African People's Socialist Party as a front that we use and raise resources and organize out of there. I want to say that we have had tremendous, tremendous support from white people. It's in a very well-traveled corridor there. So many people. We go door to door. We give out flyers. We're out in the Tower Grove Park and other places organizing with tremendous, overwhelming support from white people for the stand of reparations, for the Black Power Blueprint, for the fact that the Black Power Blueprint, which has built the mural, the basketball court, as all the things the chairman said, is the only positive thing happening in this city and in this country. We hear this over and over again, and genuine support from the white community for the work and the stand of African people for freedom and liberation and independence. So I just want to say, unity through reparations.
Yeah, I just wanted you to say what happened this morning when they came to your house and the Solidarity
Center. So they came to South St. Louis to this area?
They came to the South St. Louis at 2654. They took a battering ram. They also had drones. They brought out two people who live upstairs from the Solidarity Center down also in handcuffs with assault rifles at their heads. And they took hours going through both the center, the public part, and that, and their house. And they came to our house in South St. Louis as well. They came at 5 a.m., broke down our door, broke the door, came in, searched everything, took our computers and phones, and
What is this about? You mentioned traveled all over the world.
I'm gonna really get to that momentarily. Okay. I want Jesse. Did you want this? Were you at the Solidarity Center?
Yes.
Go ahead, please. This is Jesse Neville.
Uhuru, Chairman. I just also want to express my unity with the statement that you gave and everything that Penny Hess just said, and the Uhuru Solidarity Center, which is organizing for white reparations to African people under the leadership of the African People's Socialist Party, was mentioned, attacked this morning as part of this FBI assault on the struggle of black people for freedom and self-determination. They came in at 5 a.m. at the same time that they attacked this house and the other sites mentioned, and with FBI as well as local police, county police, upwards of around 30 different officers broke through the front door of the apartment, which is upstairs at the Solidarity Center, with a battering ram. and put myself and the other person who lives there, who's also part of the organization, in handcuffs, and had at least 6 or 7 assault rifles pointed at us when they brought us out of the building. Then they took 5.5 to 6 hours to ransack both the Solidarity Center downstairs and the apartment upstairs, and took computers, cell phones, hard drives, files, notebooks, and a whole long list of things. And that's what happened this morning.
So I want to say this. I want to ask Comrades Jesse and Comrade Zaki to say something. But they have accused us of taking money from Russia. Well, first of all, we have never taken a penny from the Russian government. But I'm not saying that because I'm morally opposed to taking money from the Russians or anybody else who wants to support the struggle for black people. Because you have a government that just gave, at the last count I saw, $40 billion. $40 billion for Ukrainians and other agents coming from the United States and all over the so-called Western world to kill Russians. And there's no question about that. $40 billion. But I will tell you this. If you go up and down West Florissant, you will see an extraordinary improvement that has occurred, not from Russian money, but from solidarity by people, from people who unite with the struggle for black people to have freedom. That's where that basketball court came down. The government didn't do that. The Russians didn't do that. Black people and our supporters, opposed to colonialism, helped to put that basketball court down there. The Russians. The Russians didn't put that, didn't demolish those places that are scars on our community and put that first-rate event center there, a black community garden there. The Russians didn't do that. Black people and other solidarity people sent money, $5, $10, $50, $100, $1,000, $10,000. That came from people who believe in the freedom of black people in the United States. The United States government doesn't believe in the freedom of black people, and that's why they raided this house. I want to go ahead and introduce you to Comrade Zaki Baruti. Zaki is the President General of the Universal People's African
People's Organization.
People's Organization. Universal. Yes.
First of all, let me just say what happened today is a really continuation of the terrorism that this government has always perpetrated against black people and poor people since the founding of this country. We unite totally with all that Chairman O'Malley Yesitele has just laid out, especially as it relates to foreign policy. Let me also make mention historically in terms of the continuum of the constant terrorism of this government toward black people. Going back to the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, where they concocted false charges because he had, at that point, one of the largest movements to liberate our people. It goes back, as Chairman mentioned, when Dr. King was murdered exactly 1 year from the date that he made a statement that the Vietnam was immoral. This is a statement to try to intimidate us that we should not speak to foreign policy. We will continue to speak to foreign policy because, as the chairman mentioned, it impacts us. When you look at $40 billion that go to Ukraine and you look at the harm that has been done to black folks, that could be our reparations.
Part of it.
Thank you. I stand corrected. But more importantly than that, not more importantly, but in like with that, it takes me back to the murder and assassination of Fred Hampton of the Black Panther Party. So this is another continuation where the FBI came in the wee hours.
4 o'clock
to assassinate Fred Hampton and Mark Clark. And the COINTEL program. So this is a continuation of America terrorism. But it will not be victor over us.
Right on.
We shall we shall be victorious and we shall have liberation in our lifetime.
This is Comrade Jesse Todd, an extraordinary older person in St. Louis. The most significant force that, in terms of occupying political office and engaged in politics, electoral politics, that we've run into in the country. And I just want Comrade Jesse to go ahead and say something.
Uhuru. Let me first say, this is not the first time I've been in the black liberation struggle in St. Louis for more than 50 years. During the 60s, they raided, starting in east on the east and west coast, and came all the way down to St. Louis without a warrant, guns drawn, with the tax money and the slavery that our ancestors and the disruption that they did to our country in Africa, bringing us over here. And they, when we got it, they did it with our money and our taxes that we were currently paying in St. Louis. And they did it today for no reason, because I know the Uhuru movement, the African People's Socialist Party, is not about but one thing. The African People's Socialist Party is about liberating our stolen resources for African people. That is not a crime, that's common sense.
Yes.
You wouldn't be raiding the white community if they were saying that they have a right to their resources. Mm-hmm. They associate with whomever they want. Mm-hmm. And this government, having FBI agents, police, that's just a good example of why I haven't voted for one budget in this city, because the police are being used in this instance to bother people who are actually preventing crime. The Euro movement has businesses. The Uhuru movement has torn down these vacant houses. Food desert, they answer the problem. Set up a market, a farmer's market. Lack of activities for our youth, basketball court, they set up a beautiful basketball court. The other thing, and also 50 other businesses creating jobs for Africans who are denied jobs only because they're African, and then while we are put in prison creating jobs in all the rural areas where you have a huge African population, and then they have the audacity to tell us, the taxpayers who are paying all the people who raided that house, this house, paying their salary, they're going to tell us who they associate with. I thought the Constitution gave us a right to associate with whomever we choose. Where did our rights go? So right there. If we want to associate with anybody, that's our right. And how can the government, and we are the government, we pay the government, how can they tell us who to associate, who to be friends with, what issues to take up when they are working for us? So I'm in 100% solidarity with the Uhuru movement,
yes,
the African People's Socialist Party, and I want to thank them, and I'm right with them, and that's a shame that we are persecuted, and we shouldn't even have to be fighting for rights. We supposed to have rights when we were so-called free, and we're still fighting for the same rights that everybody else is taking for granted. Uhuru, and thank you.
Black power!
This is Columbae and Danette, and then I'll open it up. I want Columbae and Annette. I met Columbae and Annette here. The Uhuru movement met Columbae and Annette here when we came here after a Russian policeman killed Mike Brown. And a whole bunch of other people came here. And of course, a Russian police didn't kill Mike Brown. It was a U.S. domestic soldier that they call police that killed Mike Brown. And a lot of people in this city got mobilized because they didn't want to be killed no more. They don't want to live like this no more. And that's what we organized to prevent. And so we met Comrade Columbae here. And we met other black people here who wanted to come into political life to change things. And when we said we were moving on Redbud, that you should have seen the response that came from the big shot leaders. Redbud, this is the worst place you can be. This is what they have designated this community to be. We say you can call it the worst place if you want to, but we know it didn't voluntarily become the worst place. Somebody made this, and we're going to organize the people to change this. That's why we're going where the oppression is. Not a single Russian was with us. Not a single one. Not a single one of them was with us. Only thing that came close to us was Jesse Todd, who was located here in terms of the government, Uhuru. This is Columbine Andonette, who is the international president of the International People's Democratic Uhuru Movement and the leader of our party and our Uhuru movement here in St. Louis and the Midwest region.
Uhuru. In our movement, we say touch one, touch all. And today, the state acted as the state, as we know it. And we understand, and we don't have to stand here. Chairman has laid out exactly what happened this morning. I got a phone call that we was under attack. I thought I was coming to see, you know, typically a scene where you have three or four police cars or something. But what I ran into this morning is a big, huge military armor truck in the middle of Redbud with police officers, with more armor, garment. I don't know how much that costs in tax dollars on today. On last night when I went to sleep, I went to sleep with a phone call from an African woman. Their child body was laid out on the ground for 4 hours in North County, where police officers are around, but seeing no need to pick up this baby's child's body off the ground. They terrorized the community as they did this morning. And so, as Chairman explained, I didn't know anything about an alder person. I wasn't brought into political life. But August 9th, when Mike Brown was slayed in the street, I took to the street. And I understood something in my life, that everywhere I went and seen people that looked like me in St. Louis, from the north side, from Ferguson, to the south side, or wherever we resigned in Missouri, it was the same conditions. The same conditions that murdered my brother in 95. The same conditions that murdered my brother in 97. The same conditions that took my daddy to Vietnam and dropped them back off in here and put enough dope to be the only solution to the crimes that he had seen in a war that wasn't his war. That he didn't sign up to go to war. They drafted him to war.
Yes.
When he came back with Agent Orange, that a heart disease that I have and numerous of African people are experiencing because of Agent Orange, that this country have not solved yet. So when we say we charge America with genocide, and we are not confused, and you cannot tell us how we are going to fight or liberate ourselves, we will be friends with whoever we see fit to lead our own struggle. And don't insult our intelligence by saying Russia, China, anyone will lead the African working class to liberation. The African working class will lead our own struggle. So I say to everybody that might be watching today, because what I am concerned about is the continuation of our struggle, because this is nothing, right? So I want to make sure that you be at Legacy Books and Cafe at 10 o'clock on July 31st, where Black Convention is saying, what is our agenda for the north side of St. Louis? It is our time. We must stand together. It is our time that we only have one enemy at all. That's who we got, colonialism. White power. It has been the enemy 600 years ago, and it is the enemy today. And every contradiction that you experience as a colonized person comes from that fact. It is our responsibility. It is our duty to liberate ourselves. We are our own liberators. Uhuru.
Black power.
So, are there questions that anyone, I know the gentleman here, have expressed interest in raising something.
Was just the general timeline, did they show up at 4 or 5?
It was about 5.
About 5?
Yeah.
And you guys were already up?
Well, we were up because I'm preparing to go to the gym and she's preparing. We have a doula program, like I said. There are 20 women now at our center because the hospitals don't treat black women and black children well, so they're learning to be doulas. And she was preparing for that, setting up, preparing for that, and we were sitting around talking.
Okay, and so your home here, also the Uhuru House, or no?
No, they didn't get the Uhuru House here. They got the Uhuru House in Florida.
In Florida.
And then they got the Solidarity Center in Gravois. Yes, St. Louis, yeah.
Did you see, were there any indicators that something like this was coming?
No.
They just surprised, we're going to raid your house?
Nothing. No indicators, but there's something that they obviously was well planned. They shut our phones down. We couldn't even communicate with each other. They had shut our phones down, made it and they knew who we would be calling, because those are the phones that were shut down. Mm-hmm. And then a drone coming into the house. Mm-hmm. They broke the window there. You can see the broken glass there. They put up that board there. After they broke the window there, they smashed in the back door as well. And this they say because they want to serve a search warrant. They put me in handcuffs and put us on the side because they want to serve a search warrant? That's ridiculous.
Yep.
Were there any weapons in the house?
I had a piece that's still in there. They asked me if there was a... No, they didn't get it. You know, it's a legal weapon. I mean, if white people can have a gun, at least I'm going to act like I can have a gun too. You know, so...
Why didn't they just knock then?
I don't know why they didn't knock. They said they didn't knock for my security.
You mentioned that, remind me again why you think this happened. You go to a lot of different parts of the world.
I do.
You're 80 years old, correct?
Yes.
You go to Russia, you go yes. to South Africa, all these different yes. places. You think this happened today because you guys have received money from Russian
government? We haven't received, let me tell you this. First of all, I'm apologizing for not having received money from Russia. Because I just didn't have the connections because we didn't receive any money from the Russian government.
Okay.
We participated in a conference that was organized by a global, anti-global committee that's located in Russia, but so that people from all around the world and other people from the United States were there as well.
When was that?
Wow, when was that? 2000 what? 14, 15,
well,
to a couple of
time.
Times. Yeah. But this organization is 50. We are 50 years old.
Yeah.
The Russians didn't create us.
What makes you think this has anything to do with Russia? And
that's what they said, because people have read the warrant, and they said that they think that they said this based on the assumption that Russia is interfering in elections in this country, and that Russia is interfering with the attitudes that black people and others are expressing on social media, etc. They're paid by Russians. This is the implication.
As well as it's part of an extension of a recent law that I know has been passed out of the House of Representatives. I think has been signed into law, something called the Russian Maligned Act, which tried to designate everyday people who may support or be against what the United States is doing in Ukraine. And it penalizes people, not only people here, but across this country. And I think that may be an extension.
They didn't give me. They never seen the warrant.
Did they hold one up?
They didn't hold anything up to me except a gun. And I think that's really important to say. Some people saw a warrant, but we never saw a warrant. And we were asking for a warrant over and over again. Let me see the warrant.
Okay.
They had no warrant to show
me.
Did
anybody tell you, sir, directly why they were there from the FBI or the federal?
They said that we were there because there was somebody in Russia who was going to be indicted. A Russian national in Russia was going to be indicted. And that there is some assumption of Russia influence in the politics inside the United States.
Your organization?
Well, obviously they implied that. That was implicit in what they said. And that some people saw Warren with specific names, like my name was on it, my wife's name was on it, I think Penny Hess's name was on it, etc. So yeah. But they have nothing to do with it. They put tape on their you know that little thing, the video on that you can on your phone, on your doorbell video? They put tape on the video to their doorbell so nobody could see what they were doing. So there's no record of what they were doing here. That's what they did. What the hell does that have to do with a search warrant? Yes. And then they stole. And I'm calling it theft. Yes. You know, I saw no warrant. I saw no evidence that they had anything. They showed me nothing except guns and a military, an armored vehicle out here and armed forces all around this place here. Yeah.
Were they asking any questions? Like, were they looking for a specific person?
Me and my wife. And while we were standing in the handcuff, they said that one FBI agent thought my wife had a nice dress on. This makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? Yeah, that happened. Yeah. That happened. Yeah. That happened. And didn't understand why the hell we were upset. So anyway, that's what happened. And the reason I've asked you to come here, because they were telling us while we were out there that this is going to be big news. They're going to splash it in the news. They are going to do that. And I wanted to have this ability to have this discussion so it doesn't happen in some kind of silo that they control totally. At least people can do what they want to do with this, but I'm going to say this, and then hopefully some of it will get repeated. Listen. We have a doula program that's happening now. What is the name of the hospital that this guy stole the name for the hospital? Who was the guy who stole the name for the hospital?
Palmer Key.
The guy Palmer Key, who is a land thief, who works with the land, reutilization authority that steals property legally from black people. They use taxes, and code enforcements and things like that. They've stolen thousands of properties, and they put them in what they call a land bank. And essentially, this land bank holds these properties for big-time white developers who want to take this property and then use it to make money for themselves. Paul McKee is one of them. He took some property, and now he's doing something. He's naming it for a black hospital that they closed with the Team 4 plan. You familiar with the Team 4 plan? Look at the Team 4 plan, whether it's a designated, articulated, well thought out plan to not only deprive resources to this community, but to drive it into oblivion. This is what's happening in St. Louis. This is what's happening in America. And the other thing I want to say is this. The U.S. is concerned because no African country, no country in Africa has united with it in the United Nations in an attack on Russia, and black people and most of the people around the world do not go along with it. That's why they took this basketball player who got caught in Russia with drugs, arrested with drugs in Russia. They took her, and now they claim that they're so upset about that when they're arresting black people in America every day for having marijuana. The prisons are filled with them. And they're trying to use this as a part of a propaganda war with Russia to show black people around the world, look how Russia treat black people. You understand? So they did that, but they didn't open up the prison doors for black people who are locked up because of marijuana in this country. Well, that's all right. I think, you got me, right? Okay. Uhuru. So, is there anything else?
Paul McKee is being sued, so we want to talk about that.
Well, let him be sued. I don't think they're going to come in the middle of the night with tanks and flashbang grenades or anything like that. We've had some arrests recently in St. Louis. And we didn't see anybody come in with flashbang grenades.
So was inside the house? No,
they were outside except for what they might have thrown in those windows. See the basement window there was crashed? Yeah. That window there, and it came through the back door. All we could hear all around the house was flashbang grenades. Yeah. So that was it. Yeah. My country, tis of thee.
Be stuck.
Fight back.
Be stuck.
Fight back.
Touch one.
Touch all.
Touch one.
Touch all.
One Africa.
One nation.
One Africa.
One nation.
World.
So, Sister Pat. I ain't them people. All right. So thank you.
Thank you very much for calling me.
Yeah. Yeah, come on, Zaki. We're going to do this thing. And Coffee Wright, by the way, is engaged in this political campaign for the Senate in Missouri precisely to stop this kind of activity from happening. That's part of her platform. All right. All right.
All right.
Well,
I don't know what we expect out of your country that just outlawed lynching this year.
So, yeah. Oh, that's broken. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember you. How you doing?